talk, I would like to introduce Dr. Kavita. She is a consultant pediatric ophthalmologist at Shankara Eye Hospital in Shivamogga. So she will be simplifying the esotropias for us. Over to Dr. Kavita.
At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Arun for giving me again this opportunity. I'll be talking on simple algorithm to manage esotropias. So basically, we can divide esotropias into two broad headings, that is the incomitant or the paralytic and the comitant type, which the squint is present in all gazes. So now I'll first be talking on incomitant type. Usually we take up the comitant, but then I thought first I will talk about the incomitant type. There are two headings under which I would like to do this topic. One is investigations and management treatment per se. So the general investigations are like, as Dr. Deepthi has already mentioned, it's about examining the lid features, abnormal head posture, face turn, visual acuity, cycloplegic refraction. These are essentials in all children or all patients with squint, or per se any patient for that matter. Sensory, we are looking at word for dot, begolini striatus, stereopsis, and trismus. All this has been covered very nicely by Dr. Deepthi. Now, looking at specific tests, I just made a chart for whichever condition, what are the specific tests, clinical test, or investigation that is specifically required, and that we should not miss out. Accommodate ET, we have to analyze what is the AC by A ratio. This is nothing but accommodation convergence over the accommodation. It's just a ratio. And in infantile ET, we have to look for doll's head maneuver to understand how the abduction is, whether it is a nerve palsy or infantile or a concomitant squint. Nerve palsies and restrictive strabismus, look for FTT, FGT, S or Lee screen, and neuroimaging, very important, and endocrine profile. Myogenic or myasthenia gravis, we can do the clinical test like the ice pack test and fatigue test. Nevertheless, it's good enough to get an opinion from the physician or neurologist. In case of trauma and then squint, we have to look for FTT, FGT, and neuroimaging is very, very helpful. If there is convergence excess, or how to understand convergence excess and divergence insufficiency, we have to look for near point of convergence and accommodation. These are the general guidelines. This is first is observation. You observe for the squint, whether it disappears or it is there or it's increasing. Spectacles, it could be monofocals, bifocals, or progressive addition lenses. Contact lens and refractive surgery, of course, it's a question mark. Very essential is the amblyopia therapy, and follow up these children regularly. Last would be the surgery. Now, the first common type of incomitant esotropia that we come across is lateral rectus palsy. In this figure, you can see that there is, in the primary division, there is esotropia, and in dextro version, there's limitation of abduction, and lever version, it is okay. So we would go about doing FTT, treat the underlying condition, whatever it is. Better to take a neurologist opinion, especially a pediatric neurologist. Wait for resolution, then we can think of doing the routine residual, for the residual deviation, we can do the resect procedure, depending on how much the deviation is present. To improve the abduction despite the first procedure, we can think of doing the muscle transposition procedure, namely Hammel-Schemes, where the muscle from the vertical recti are divided and brought and placed before the lateral rectus. So this gives additional strength to the lateral rectus, or we can do the Jensen procedure where the muscle, vertical muscles are split and then tied up to the lateral rectus. So only thing we have to keep in mind about anterior segment ischemia when we are tackling multiple muscles. The other type is the DRS type 1, where there is abduction. In this patient, you can see that there is esotropia and there is abduction deficit in lever version and narrowing of palpebral fissure. So in this, the most important is you look for refractive error, especially if there's an accommodative component. You correct with glasses. Many times the AHP gets corrected. And also one important thing is that if you correct the accommodative component, we can exclude the post-op consecutive exotropia. So depending on deviation, we can think about doing one muscle or two muscles in each muscle, one muscle in both the eyes, that is medial rectus recession. And then there's one more recommendation also, although we learned that we shouldn't touch the lateral rectus, Kraft recommended that for esotropia of 20 to 25 to prisms with normal adduction and limited abduction and no retraction or vertical shoots, we can do a minimal resection of lateral rectus of about 3 millimeter and gives good results. If it is associated with the vertical shoots, we should think of doing the Y split, that is lateral rectus is recessed and divided into two equal halves, and then it is placed across 10 to 15 millimeter across. If there is oblique overaction, we can think of tackling the obliques, do the weakening procedure on the obliques. The other conditions are the myogenic causes. Commonly we encounter is myasthenia gravis. This is very easily detectable in clinic, but only thing we should have high degree of suspicion. This is well treated with medical treatment. Take a neurologist or physician opinion. Traumatic laceration and esotropia, it depends on the nature of trauma. We need to do neuroimaging, and this requires an orbit oculoplasty surgeon as well. Multiple surgeries may be required. Congenital causes, wait and observe, and then take a call on the squint that is persistent. Then we can do the cosmetic surgery. Myopathies, especially that we see is CPUO. We can think of crutch glasses, cosmetic surgery, and also most important is to take a pediatrician opinion. Strabismus does not mean surgery all the time. Most important, rule out pseudostrabismus by help of family history, simple clinical pinch test, and serial photographs. Now coming to concomitant esotropia, there are two types broadly, accommodative and non-accommodative. There are various types under each category, which I'll be talking about it. Accommodative esotropia, first is the refractive error type that is associated with it. You do a full cycloplegic refraction and you know that you can get this corrected with glasses. Anything more than 2.5 diopters, you can correct with glasses. It can be fully corrected or partially corrected where there is residual squint. Then if there is partially squint which is remaining, then we can think of surgery in this. It's well corrected here. The other entity is that there is ESO deviation which is more for near. If it is more than 15 diopters, think of bifocals. You start with 2.5 diopters. Typically, you give the executive type, which is not available now. So we think of B bifocal or progressive addition lenses. Now, coming to the various non-accommodative ETs are the essential infantile ET. This is, once you consider that there's no refractive error, there is cross fixation, it is clinical diagnosis, we can think of doing surgery. Bimedial recession is the opted method. And the other one is the essential acquired, which starts off late. So neuroimaging is required for this condition, and then you can think of surgery. The other variants are nystagmus blockade and Leggett's syndrome. Acute onset, rule out neurological causes, wait for a while and then take up for surgery. The various other types are sensory ET, cyclic ET, consecutive ET, all of them need observation and then we can think of surgery. But most important is to establish consistent readings of the prism deviations and whether both doctor and family are
Sorry to interrupt, ma'am.
Yeah, done. I'm done.
Ma'am, the time is up. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm done. Early surgery, of course, has greater advantage to take. When in doubt, repeat refraction, watch on bifocals, consistent measurements of the deviation before surgery is required, regular follow-up, and be prepared for post-op surprises, especially consecutive exotropia, as you see in this below picture. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Kavita. That was an exhaustive presentation on esotropia in a short duration. Here, I would like to tell all the participants, the most important is the esotropias are actually the more common type of deviation in children. and they are more dangerous than the exotropias. Why? Because esotropias, they start very early in life. So many of the times before the first 6 months of life, the esotropias will start. And because they start early in life, they disrupt the binocular vision and they cause very dense amblyopia. So the simple nomogram to follow while you see a patient, if you suppose see a child with esotropia, first thing is just do a visual acuity assessment to diagnose amblyopia. Second step, do a cycloplegic refraction, look for hypermetropia. So if there is a significant hypermetropia, you correct the deviation with glasses. And if the deviation is fully corrected with glasses, just continue with the amblyopia therapy and glasses. If the deviation is not corrected with glasses, then go for the surgery. So that will be a very simple algorithm to manage a case of esotropia. Dr. Murali, any additional inputs regarding esotropia?
One more. Good morning, everyone. One more important thing that I wanted to add was that botulinum toxin is a very useful option in acquired concomitant esotropia, especially like if it is less than 1 year, we can consider botulinum toxin. So botulinum toxin can be.